So you might ask the question, what is Kabbalah? And in pursuit of that answer, you might be immediately directed towards certain fairly fail-proof conclusions. The first is that it is a form of Jewish mysticism. The second is that it has something to do with something called the Sephirot, which is a diagram of what's known as the Tree of Life and somewhat represents a primitive explanation for molecules. It also bears a striking resemblance in certain ways to a Kundalini transcendental meditationist chakra system. So you will learn as you delve deeper, no doubt, that Kabbalah can produce products such as the Kabbalah deck. I kind of doubt you can see that, actually. But you can see the symbol on it for sure. And the symbol on it for sure means that it's a Jewish pictogram for peace and open-handedness and open-heartedness and open-eyedness and open universe, and it's basically a female symbol to depict a compassionate tolerance and open acceptance of all things, and at the same time it's done in an esoteric script which is mastered by only certain groups of Jewish scribes. It's micography, I think, or yeah, I think it's micography. So anyways, there you'll notice that if you look at that deeper, that it contains characters, and the deck inside of that contains the entire Jewish alphabet. So as you dig deeper into what is Kabbalah, you will find that it has something to do with the Jewish alphabet itself, and the the Hebrew alphabet itself, which although you may think it doesn't, bears striking resemblance to the alphabet that we use in the West, and striking resemblance to a Greek alphabet, and striking resemblance to alphabet the Kirinishka, and striking resemblance, as it so happens, to Pali Sanskrit. So the in Hebrew, though, the Hebrew study of this is it actually applies the order of the letters as they appear in your, I think it's a lexicography, maybe. That might be overstating that, actually, linguistically. I get my linguistic terms mixed up because they're not all agreed upon, yet it seems that you can make it into a science. So the alphabet as it appears, each letter has a value, each letter has a kind of hidden set of meanings or teachings behind it, each letter has really honestly its own character, its own flavor, its own spirit, its own essence. It stands alone. Each letter in the alphabet stands alone. And so when you've studied this enough, you will find as you go further that when combined with the Sephiroth and the teachings of the Zohar and the musings of millions of Kabbalistic Jews over several centuries, that you can begin to look deeply into what is known as Torah, which are the Greek is the Pentateuch. You can look deeply into the first five books of the Hebrew Bible, the Tanakh, is known as the Tanakh. Christians call it an Old Testament. Epic fail. So you can look deeply into the Tanakh, the first five books, the Torah, and by reading it in its proper language and proper syntactical structure and proper grammatics and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And by the way, for those of the atheist crowds among the internet who believe the rumor floating around that the Hebrew Bible wasn't canonized until somewhere in the Middle Ages, there's obviously some evidence for that. But Jews themselves, as far as I understand them, should also be considered the authorities on their own stuff. And they argue that their book was canonized more or less by somewhere around 300 or 100 or something BC, before Jesus was born, if that matters to anyone. It matters to you if you think it's 2012, whether it matters to you or not. At any rate, it's been suggested, of course, if you buy Dr. Bronner's soap and you read all that shit on the bottle, that changes with every new, you know, big set of bottles, it seems like. That, and I've learned this from my Hebrew friends and my rabbi as well, that the normal partitions of Judaism in the year zero do not take into account Hillel and, fuck, I'm not going to bring that other name out right now, I just know it, so I'm not going to try. But Hillel is the one that matters, is a rabbi, Yehuda or whatever, and he, you know, apparently they believe there's at least legendary makings of whisperings of tales that this guy was Jesus's mentor, or Yeshua Bar Yosef. Excuse me, my kid has a cough and I'm picking it up. I heard my throat chakra must be blocked. At any rate, this guy, Hillel, Rabbi Hillel, is a group of basically feminist, interfaith, communistic, peace, love, happiness, hippie Jews, if you want to put it that way. I'm not making this up, people. So anyways, and they emphasized looking beyond the texts and everything. So Kabbalah has its own internal fundamentalist, literalist, scripturalist, textologist, eisegesist, whatever, exosegesist, whatever, I don't even want to say these words anymore. So it has its own like conservative versus liberal dichotomy within it. Kabbalah is strictly a Jewish pursuit in a lot of ways, and if you're not Jewish and you don't speak or understand Hebrew, or you don't get the meanings behind, you know, the spheres of the Sephiroth, and you know, you can't read Zohar in its original language, or haven't read Zohar in Hebrew, then you aren't a Kabbalist and you have no business even really worrying about it. And you know, New Age fascination with Gematria and all of these other forms of Kabbalistic interest are all well and good and interesting, and that's all fine and dandy, but really there's just, you know, the brothers in the hats with the curly sideburns living in Brooklyn who actually do this stuff for a living, and then there's the rest of you Koyim. I don't study Kabbalah. I read Zohar, and I've spent obviously enough time to know enough about it to just peel off that little miniature lecture right there. But Kabbalah doesn't come out of Torah or understanding Hebrew to me. So I'm going to start this lecture now. This isn't a lecture. That was a lecture. This is me rambling. I'm going to start this ramble now with a title, and it's called My Interpretation of Kabbalism by the dude Dr. Rock, Domo Rock, Rockhead, King Bullshit, He who sees his own face. I did not give myself these names. What is Kabbalism really? Kabbalism is the reality that the universe breaks down into patterns, and it always breaks down into patterns as far as human beings are concerned, because, first of all, we are always faced with infinity. You've never not been staring infinity in the face. There is always more input in front of you than you know what to do with. And frankly, that's rather frightening for human beings. And, you know, just the organic principle of life on planet Earth is one of order and patterns and replication of purpose and meaning. So that's really, Kabbalism is just really, that's the way the world breaks down. It just breaks down into these pieces that break down into these other pieces that break down into these other pieces, and everything is at once a container and contained. One of the reasons that Kabbalism fits very nicely with Tai Chi, as some people have noticed, is because Tai Chi and Kabbalism notice the same essential characteristic principles of the universe that cannot be denied, no matter what, whether you're a rational animist or a positivist materialist. It's why you never see atheism taking on Lao Tzu. It's because they wouldn't have a way to do that. Most scientists, if they've read the Tao Te Ching, they are like, wow, good teaching. I don't see people who have beef with Taoism outside of Chinese people who have the experience of having Taoism mixed with your state government system for thousands of years. So, also interestingly enough, just to mention this in the Kabbalism segment, Taoism is the other major sixth religion of the world, and it's often confused for something called Confucianism, which is influenced by Taoism. Confucianism is a state level method of applying the Tao to a kingdom or a place of influence that you rule over if you are the chosen leader, or you take in control of everyone's freedoms and rights with your military force. So Kabbalism and Taoism fit together very nicely. And Kabbalism just continually is very obviously tied into language. Hebrew, notwithstanding, I don't see the how it matters. The reality for me is that Kabbalism is living and breathing inside of English. And I've heard that it lives and breathes in other languages as well, Chinese, for example. And that any piece of English writing, especially if it's done by a Kabbalist, will be loaded with multiple meanings. One of the reasons I think people believe Jesus was a Kabbalist is because you can clearly see by reading the red type in the Gospels, it was written to reflect someone who is speaking in multiple styles and meanings at once. They are using so many different aspects of the universe simultaneously that they can say things that mean more than one thing. The reality, of course, is, especially if you speak English and you understand it well, words don't have single meanings. Words in English have sometimes many meanings, and sometimes words can even be used in the exact opposite way of their meanings, especially if you get into pidgins and, realizations of language that have not been seen or heard of before. People bad, for instance, has been used to mean good, and vice versa. The nature of the universe, of course, is one of paradox, and so as words become formalized and held to certain standards, they instantly kind of almost lose their credibility and fall out of fashion, such is the nature of the Tao. And so that is a reason to study these things, because it would give you some level of mastery over why things are the way they are at any given moment in time. For example, why should there be something called a shift right now? And what does that mean? And how many things does it mean? And what, why is simply that word all by itself enough to really get a whole bunch of people rolling together on a shared vision that no one ever came together and said, what is this? No one ever did that. No, shift was just, I submit to you that shift was just spit out into the living biointelligent ethosphere. And what some people call the Akashic Field. And but I would say is almost not the Akashic Field. It's more, the Akashic Field is more a record of that, and then that is actually the collective consciousness, or depending on who you're listening to, Durkheim or Jung, right? If you're listening to Durkheim, it's the collective consciousness. If you're listening to Jung, it's the collective unconsciousness. Effectively, as far as I see it, those two things are the same thing. Kabbalah, that's what I'm talking about. Two completely opposite words to describe the exact same phenomenon. Right? Why is everything one when actually, honestly, obviously, everything is two at minimum? And, you know, the idea is, of course, that one are two. And the mystical secret behind this universe really is that zero plus one equals two. And the mystical secret behind reproduction is that 1 plus 1 equals 3. And the mystical secret behind enlightenment is that 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 equals 5. Because once you place yourself in the middle of that, you're elevated, your perspective becomes more holistic. It doesn't make your vibration higher. That's a misunderstanding, actually, of everything, and it's really one that I would expect from a computer that was reincarnated as a person. But there are a lot of those running around, by the way, these days. What I would say now is that this rant is finished.